some of you may have seen me speak at Ethereal. I did one of the keynotes at the Ethereal conference a couple of weeks ago. And, you know, a little bit about my background. Obviously, of Asian ancestry, but I was born in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. My dad ended up running research for a chemical company called Natco Chemical Company in the Midwest. He's a kind of an inventor type patent. He has 26 patents on a bunch of stuff. When I was a kid, he bought me a Radio Shack 101 electronics projects kit. And I don't know if you guys have ever seen that, but it's a piece of cardboard with springs and parts. And I used to build stuff with them. And when I was in junior high, somehow I saw a schematic of something called a blue box, if any of you guys know what that is, which are, the first company that Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak had wasn't a computer company. It was a company that made a frequency synthesizer that happened to generate the tone that unlocked the computer switching system so you could make free phone calls. And I basically built that thing out of my Radio Shack 101 kit. And that put me on a path of being an electrical engineer. I learned to design semiconductor chips. And I moved out here in 1984, just as there was a group that had been meeting since the late 70s. And it was just tailing off at that time. But that that group was called the Homebrew Computer Club. And this group, as Louis and crew described, the objective is to do something like that. That group, bunch of people of all ages, but mostly young people, interested in the field of microcomputers before they existed. And in those days, people still had computers that were pieces of wood with switches on them that you would set to ones and zeros to create patterns that were programs that would run on these little machines. And the kids that would attend that group, they rented a room at the Stanford Linear Accelerator initially. They were kids like Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak and Bill Gates and Paul Allen, the guys that started Sun Microsystems, Alan Shugart that started Seagate, and many, many, many companies came out of that group of people. And maybe in this room, there's a couple of folks like that, which is, makes me very excited because I feel like we're on the front of another wave, and that opportunity exists. The energy around this segment, I mean, you're here for a reason because you feel it, you know it. There is some kind of foundational change driven by technology that is occurring to our society right now, and all of you are part of that right in the beginning. And both the PC and both the silicon wave and the internet wave, they took a long time to to bake. I had my first experience mining Bitcoin in 2009, really just as an experiment. And having worked on arcane technologies and chips and things like that before, I that are widely used, but nobody knows. You're all using those things, but they're not things that are the forefront of what you think about every day. I actually just presume that the Bitcoin would be like that, and it would be just this this interesting world of people that were working on this stuff. And never did I think it would have the kind of public attention that it has. And I was just speaking to somebody on the phone earlier today that people are always looking for that sort of the Netscape moment in waves of technology. And I actually think that it might have actually already happened. Looking backwards, when the internet was around in 1991 to 93, I was already in venture capital by then. And I used to walk around these conferences thrown by O'Reilly Associates, and I can't remember what they were called, but they weren't called internet conferences. They were just like O'Reilly, networking or something like that. And companies would hand out 5-inch floppy disks, and they were CompuServe, and they were Prodigy, and they were, disks that had file transfer protocol and a Gopher, early browsers, access to Usenet news, and the user interfaces were terrible. And take these things and put them in your computer and you connect to it. I mean, I don't know how many of you use the modem, but you turn the thing on and you put the thing, you connect, and then it was really slow and not a good UI, but it led to something when Netscape sort of simplified that user interface. And then whether or not you used it, everybody knew about it. And so I think we might have had that Netscape moment with Bitcoin already, because I'll bet that a lot of you have some Bitcoin, but I'll bet there's a very high percentage of people in this room that actually don't own Bitcoin, but you know about it. You know, it's kind of like, you know, the internet in that era. And I think we might be at that kind of a moment now where that was the marker, in a way, for massive interest, massive potential adoption on its way. Business models still to be sort of sorted out, but a lot of interest, you know, and I think there's, whenever there's human capital, when, you know, there's different kinds of capital that get put into the creation of value and the creation of companies, part of it's financial capital, but a lot of it's basically human capital. And I have not seen this kind of energy and just massive amounts of human capital, not just in this room, but everywhere I go, being applied to something all at the same time in this kind of force. So welcome all of you, because you know we're doing this thing again, I think. And I'm hoping that somewhere in this room there's gonna be a couple of folks like that. And you know, mark my words, there's gonna be a lot of market value created by some set of people in this room. So stay close. And I think, you know, as Louis said, this is the beginning of a series. And it's really about community. None of the stuff that happened in that era or in the internet era would have happened without people sharing ideas and collaborating. One of the things that that really stood out to me, being on the West Coast, and I'd spent some time on the East Coast as well, the ability for people in this area to share information, very, very different than other parts of the world. Probably many of you already know that. Like a lot of people that come from other areas, they have an idea for a startup, they want to keep it secret. They don't want to tell anybody. You know, or we're at, and the East Coast has changed a lot in the last 10 years, but 20 years ago, startups were, I wouldn't say they were shunned, but it wasn't prestigious to be in a startup. It was prestigious to be a Digital Equipment Corp or an IBM or, you know, working for a big company that gave you theoretical lifetime security. And you know, we all know how that works out. Most of, you know, big companies don't see what's happening because I think there's a change. I'll digress for one more moment. I think one of the things that the blockchain is enabling with its decentralization is a return to humanity. And what I mean by that, humans have been around for, in some way, shape, or form, for maybe 6 million years. They've only been organized for about 4,000. And the notion of a company, as we know it today, the big companies that guys like Jamie Dimon head, those have really only been around for 100 years, maybe 200, but really 100, you know, because of the Industrial Revolution, right? So for substantially all of human history, for 99.99% of human history, maybe the math is not exact, but you know, you get the point. People were tribal. They worked in fluid networks. You might go with 5 of your friends to go hunt for some food one day, and 5 different friends to go gather food another day. And you didn't belong as a cog in the wheel in a giant machine. You were an atom or a molecule on a fabric that was free-floating that could reassemble as needed in a decentralized way to accomplish the objectives of that little tribe at the time. The blockchain is a return to that sort of behavior on a fabric where everyone's connected and has a little bit more information about what everyone else does instead of being just geographically confined. So I don't know what that means for the structure of our society, but I think it has some profound implications if it really seeps into it, because we, well, as you know, society or race, whatever you want to call it, return to what humans have been for 99.99% of their history. And so it'll be interesting to see, you know, if we come back here 50 years from now, it'll be really interesting to see if this wave has really taken hold. And you see it, we were just talking earlier to Catherine about, she goes to a group of parents, you know, talk about Cub Scout or something, and everyone's with different, you know, from different industry groups. everyone's talking about the applicability of blockchain to their segment. You know, so we're looking at something that might be very foundational, very pervasive, that is, it could change a lot of things. So with that, I'm going to turn it back over to Louis, because we've got a couple of very interesting presentations, and then we're going to move into a panel. Thank you.
It's really hard to hear.